Es ist interessant, fangen wir erstmal anders an. Also erstmal, mein Name ist Ralf Engelke, gehöre mit hier zu diesem Organisationsteam vom Netzwerk Grundeinkommen Deutschland. Und wir haben uns vorhin mal so das Programm angeguckt und haben festgestellt, der Workshop 12, das war ein rein brasilianischer Workshop, der vorher schon stattgefunden hat. Und jetzt haben wir wieder sehr viele Menschen aus Brasilien. Und wir wollen aber nicht, dass es zu einem brasilianischen Workshop wird, sondern dass wir wirklich uns strikt daran halten, an dem Titel vom bedingten sozialen Cash-Transfer zum unbedingten Grundeinkommen, welche Wege wir dort gehen können, damit man da hinkommt. Und ja, das wäre schön, wenn wir uns da an diesen Fahrplan halten können. Wir haben uns das so gedacht, dass der Eduardo Saplicy anfängt mit einem Statement so von 10 Minuten. Dann Luis Hendrik da Silva Palava, ist das hoffentlich richtig, die zweite Person ist, die dann da weitermacht. Und Bruno Augusta Pereira, die dritte Person ist, die dann spricht. Und Rolf Kühnemann, der dann auch nochmal was sagen wird. Und dann wollten wir schon versuchen, auch nochmal 2 Runden zu machen ins Publikum mit dem Mikrofon. Und dass wir dann hier nochmal das Podium mit Fragen von euch ja, versuchen zu klären oder die sich dann nochmal gestellt haben. Und genau, erstmal schon mal schönen Dank, dass auch alle da sind und der Einladung gefolgt sind. Und möchte dann den Eduardo Saplicy das Wort erteilen mit der Bitte, dass er 10 Minuten ein Statement gibt. Erstmal herzlichen Dank.
Dear friends of Bian, Professor Ralf Engelke, am I pronouncing well your name? Engelke. Ralf Engelke, I'm very glad here to meet again Professor Rolf Kühnemann, and Bruno Augusto Pereira. She has been an enthusiast of the basic income, and I am very glad to be here with her, and I'm very glad also that the organizers of this 14th International Congress of Bian had first invited Minister Teresa Campelo of the Social Development and Fight Against Hunger in Brazil, that has the responsibility for the main aim of the President Dilma Rousseff's government to eradicate extreme poverty and eliminate at the most absolute poverty in Brazil and to improve the income distribution. Due to medical advices, before she entered the government, she had a problem of cancer, and she's very well now, but following the medical advices, and the doctor told her not to make long travels, so that's why she's not here today. But we are very glad to have here the National Secretary of the Citizens' Income. And you know why the National Secretary has this name? Luis Henrique da Silva de Paiva. Because, well, in the 2 laws, about the Bolsa Família and the citizens' basic income in Brazil, were sanctioned almost, well, one, the citizen's basic income on the 8th of January 2004, and the Bolsa Família program on the 9th of January 2004, and they are quite connected. Why? Because the citizen's basic income law says that an equal citizen's income to all inhabitants of Brazil, including those foreign residents who are living in Brazil for 5 years or more, will have the right to an income sufficient to attend their basic needs, for example, with food, health, education, and this will be higher and higher with the progress of the nation, taking into account the budget possibilities. But there is a paragraph that says that the citizen's basic income will, that should start in 2005, but it will be introduced step by step, taking into account those most in need under the executive criteria. Well, Luiz Henrique da Silva de Paiva for many years has been contributing to the federal government under President Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, and then he was appointed to be the National Secretary and of the Citizens' Income. And the name, this National Secretary, the man who is responsible for managing the Bolsa Família program, has the name, is the National Secretary of the Citizens' Income, taking into account what is written in the law of the citizen's basic income. So he has a certain responsibility in coming here to the Basic Income International Congress. I would like to remind here that in August 1996, when Professor Philippe Van Parijs came to Brazil, invited by the University of São Paulo and the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro to lecture there. We already were friends. I had met Philippe Van Parijs in London with so many of you that are here, like Guy Stanley, Klaus Hoff, and not at that time James Edward Mead, but the daughter of James Edward Mead in that London conference. There was a homage to the contribution of James Edward Mead because of all that he has written since an outline of economic policy to the Labour government in 1935 until 1989, 1992, and 1995. The trilogy about Agatotopia, and I was referring in the last seminar to him because in August 1996, I took Professor Philippe Van Parijs to an audience with President Fernando Henrique Cardoso and the Minister of Education of the time, Paulo Renato Souza, who has died now, and his team. And there was a discussion about a guaranteed minimum income through a negative income tax, and also there were some experiences in Brazil, local experience about guaranteed minimum income programs related to educational opportunities. And the local experiences of those programs that were also called Bolsa Escola in the federal district in the city of Campinas, of Belo Horizonte, Ribeirão Preto, Belém, Mundo Novo, and so many others, had positive results and repercussions in the National Congress. And about six congressmen proposed that the proposed project bills of laws, according to which the federal government would start to finance those municipalities that would start programs in that direction. And so Professor Philippe Vampares told President Fernando Henrique Cardoso that to start, well, the objective, the best thing would be an unconditional basic income. But this would be difficult to do it right away. And to start guaranteed minimum income to families as long as their children are going to school, since one of the problems at that time of Brazil was so many poor families that used to send their children to work very early at 7, 8, 9, 10 years of age instead of going to school. And so Philippe Vampares said, well, to start a guaranteed minimum income relating to educational opportunities would be an investment in human capital, and it's a good step. And so the President Fernando Henrique Cardoso gave the green light for the Congress to approve projects that characterize the guaranteed minimum income to families as long as their children are going to school, and then as long as their parents take the children to take the necessary vaccines. And then there were other programs like the gas aid programs. And President Lula, who had as his main objective to eradicate hunger in Brazil, he started a program to a sort of a food stamp program, giving 50 reais per month to poor families as long as they spend their money in food. But already in October 2003, those four programs were unified and rationalized under the name of Bolsa Família program, the theme of what Luis Henrique will be speaking to you all. But I would like to tell you that more and more, being persuaded that the basic income is the first and best proposal, I am in my past month, I have been going all over Brazil and I have stimulated all the mayor candidates to start municipal, local experiences of the citizens' basic income, unconditional to all, even if they are going to do it gradually, including for the candidate of my party, the Workers' Party. He has written in his municipal plan that we are going in the direction of introducing an unconditional basic income in collaboration with the state government and the federal government. And I hope that perhaps if not in the 15th, but in the 16th International Congress of Bien, I'll be able to tell you about how closer we will be, if not already, applying an unconditional citizens' basic income to all Brazilians now that we are 194 million Brazilians. And Bruna will tell about the experience of a group of people that became so enthusiastic about that started this experience already in one small village. And as well, tomorrow, Marina Nóbrega and Francisco Nóbrega will tell you about the local experience of the first municipality of Brazil that has approved a law to institute a basic income. Next year, it will be the first one, Santo Antônio do Pinhal. And her proposal is already approved by the city council, is to start paying, since it will not be possible to pay the 6,600 inhabitants a citizen's basic income as they would like to do it. They have approved already a proposal to start paying it with those who are born there in the first year, about 100 people. So it's one possible step until one day we'll have it to all inhabitants of the earth. Okay? Congratulations to you all.
Well, first of all, on behalf of Ms. Teresa Campelo, Minister of Social Development, I'd like to thank the organizers for the kind invitation to be here tonight. As the person in charge of the secretariat responsible for the Bolsa Família program, I also have to say that it's a pleasure to be here. Two previous secretaries were present at the 2008 and the 2009 BN Congress, and we have been following with great interest the debates about basic income. At the same time, we have perceived a genuine interest from this basic income network regarding the Bolsa Família program. This mutual interest does not mean that defenders of conditional cash transfers, on the one hand, and basic income, on the other, do not point to differences between their proposals. These differences do exist. However, after presenting the Bolsa Família program and our perspective on conditionalities, as requested by the Congress organizers, I would suggest that these differences are being excessively emphasized to a point where conditional cash transfers and basic income are sometimes regarded as opposite to each other. Unfortunately, it's not rare nowadays to read that the very existence of conditional cash transfers should be considered an obstacle and not an opportunity in the implementation of basic income. Here, I would suggest something different. I agree that conditional cash transfers are not necessarily a safe path to basic income. However, if we reject conditional cash transfers as a possible route to basic income, or at least to achieving some of its principles, we are certainly closing a door to opportunities that might make these principles more likely to be accepted and adopted in our societies. In Brazil, the first conditional cash transfer programs emerged in the mid-90s as local-level initiatives. Between 2001 and 2003, four different conditional cash transfer programs emerged at the national level. Bolsa Família was created in October 2003 to unify these programs, increase their coverage, and improve their management. It reached 11 million beneficiary families in 2006, and 13 million by the end of 2010. Currently, more than 13.5 million families, or approximately 50 million people, receive their benefits on a monthly basis. This comes to about $10 billion a year, which represents less than 0.5% of GDP. Along with its expansion, Bolsa Família has been, as expected, reducing exclusion errors and increasing take-ups. Surprisingly, its targeting of the poorest improving during this period. Bolsa Família follows the basic design of conditional cash transfers. It's a selective program. It works based on a targeting mechanism. It pays relatively modest benefits whose level varies depending on how poor and how large the family is. These benefits are paid to women as often as possible. It's conditional, which means that school attendance and visits to healthcare centers are required and monitored on a regular basis. Finally, other actions are taken to try to improve prospects of beneficiaries in the labor market, such as job training and support for agricultural production. Bolsa Família has been paying up to now several different benefits. A flat rate benefit is paid to every family living below the extreme poverty line, which is roughly speaking $1.25 PPP per capita per day. Extra benefits up to 5 are paid according to the number of children aged 15 or younger and to the number of pregnant and nursing women. These benefits paid to all families living below the poverty line of roughly 2.50 PPP per capita per day. Poor families can also receive up to 2 benefits for adolescents aged 16 and 17. And finally, a new top-up benefit was created recently and has been paid to all extremely poor beneficiary families with children up to 6 years old, guaranteeing that the whole family will cross the extreme poverty line. Overall, the minimum transfer is 16 per month, paid to a poor family with only one child under the age of 15. And after the new top-up benefit, there is no longer a ceiling of transfers. In a few cases, benefits may be above $500 a month. The mean transfer overall is below $70. And for those families that receive the new top-up benefit, the mean transfer is $120. School attendance and visits to healthcare centers have been monitored since 2006. Monitoring rates have been increasing in the last few years and reached almost 90% of beneficiary children and adolescents attending schools. That is more than 15 million adolescents and children, and 73% of beneficiary families visiting healthcare. Monitoring covers only beneficiary families and is performed by the ministries of education and health and their corresponding area in local administrations. Authors suggested that Bolsa Família program is effectively unconditional, which is not correct. Certainly, we do not have a draconian approach to conditionalities. They were planned in order to reinforce access to services in education and health. There is a long process until families have their benefits canceled for not complying with conditionalities. During this process, local social workers have access to information about families whose children are not attending school or not getting vaccinated. In other words, monitoring conditionalities produces clear signals of social vulnerability and can help to drive social work activities. We know that coordination of different areas in public administration is not something that happens naturally. We also know that services in education and health, even when provided on a universal basis like in Brazil, frequently reach unequally the poor and the non-poor. Conditionalities have induced areas of education, healthcare, and social assistance to channel their attention to the most vulnerable, improving government coordination and raising concerns about the quality of services addressed to them. It's not by chance that most of the educational advances that we have experienced in recent years in Brazil relate to the 40% poorest. This is definitely an advantage of targeted program. It may focus some light on the most vulnerable population and create a demand for better and more coordinated provision of universal services. Bolsa Família has been increasing its take-up rates, raising the level of transfers, maintaining its target on those who are worse off, and being effective in terms of monitoring the access by its beneficiaries to services in education and healthcare. These points are not being enough to avoid all sorts of criticisms, including those that come from defenders of basic income. I don't have time here to talk about all those criticisms, so we will consider here one of the most frequent, that these programs tend to be complex from an administrative point of view and, in consequence, very expensive. This is one of the most common criticisms addressed to conditional cash transfers. When Bolsa Família was being implemented, critics suggested that administrative requirements were so complex that its management would be very expensive and that monitoring conditionalities would hardly be feasible. But this criticism is rather an assumption to be proven, and in two different senses. First, it's not necessarily true that administrative costs of selective programs are high. Second, It's doubtful that the administrative cost of basic income will be significantly lower. The Bolsa Família program demonstrated that it's possible to adopt a relatively cheap targeting strategy. We don't use real or proxy means tests, information about income is declared by families. This information is cross-checked with other administrative records, keeping data as sound as possible. It has been enough for the program to keep its good targeting on the poorer in recent years, even with increasing number of beneficiaries. Administrative costs, as a consequence, have not been a concern. In the central level, these costs are less than 5% of the program's total cost. This includes all costs of developing and maintaining IT systems, making the payment throughout the country, and subsidizing local government activities. Based on 4 urban case studies, Lindert and colleagues estimated an overall administrative cost, including costs to local governments, at 12% of the total costs. Currently, our concern is not with lowering administrative costs, not with keeping them low, but with increasing them. If our challenge is to pay benefits to all poor families, we must be prepared to reach the hard to reach. And this is not cheap. Benefits paid only to those who knock on the government's door may be considered universal only from a formal perspective, never from a substantive standpoint. Reaching the most vulnerable will be expensive, whether the program is targeted or universal, since it implies an active, not passive, posture of the state. Overall, the assumption that universal, unconditional benefits will reach everyone at a low administrative cost only by eliminating restrictions typically present in selective programs should not be accepted so easily, nor should be easily accepted the assumption that selective programs will always be over-bureaucratized and expensive from an administrative point of view. We should not believe that basic income and the Bolsa Família program are diametrically opposed. A program strictly addressed to a minimal group of extremely poor people, based on the concept of absolute poverty, transferring stamps, not money, associated with a large group of conditionalities implemented in a punitive way towards its beneficiaries, yes, this program could be perhaps opposite of basic income, but this is not the case for the Bolsa Família program. Bolsa Família is not universal, but is far from being minimal. As we have seen, it reaches more than a quarter of the Brazilian population, and its coverage has been increasing. The social acceptance of such a large social program does not mean that this program is necessarily the way to basic income, but it certainly contributes to making the general idea of a benefit paid to all more acceptable. It's also the first time in Brazil that a scheme has been addressed to people of working age. For a long time, benefits were just socially accepted when paid to older people and the disabled. The acceptance of the Bolsa Família program is also the acceptance of the idea that a wider public should benefit of social protection. Again, this idea does not put Bolsa Família in the path towards basic income, but makes the concept more acceptable. The program's current expansion is fundamentally based on the idea that high exclusion errors are not defensible. Quite a few initiatives have been taken to give local administrations proper information about their performance, as well as financial support for their activities in reaching the poor population. The very idea that every poor family in Brazil must be reached does not mean that the program's benefits were turned into an individual right from a formal point of view, but that they are treated as a right from a substantive point of view. This also contributes to make a rights-based universal program more acceptable. The argument that conditional trust transfers in general and the Bolsa Família program in particular will not naturally lead us to basic income may be accepted. If there were a natural path to basic income, probably we would have many more cases of universal unconditional benefits paid to all. But I advocate that the presence of Bolsa Família in the Brazilian scenario, where social protection was strongly based on social insurance until quite recently, makes some principles of basic income more, not less, acceptable. This suggestion that programs like Bolsa Família are an obstacle and not an opportunity to these principles may be classified as an adversarial approach by supporters of basic income, which is ultimately fruitless. However, admitting that some basic income principles may be promoted by a selective program like Bolsa Família does not imply that basic income should replace this selective program as soon as possible. Nor does it mean accepting that basic income is necessarily a better way to achieve results associated with some of these principles, such as, for instance, poverty reduction. It just means that some of these principles can be promoted and some of these results can be achieved by other sorts of programs. Arguments in favor of basic income, for instance, its administrative efficiency, or higher effectiveness in fighting poverty should not be accepted so easily. Most of these arguments, if not all, are yet to be proven, and at least a few are probably wrong. Reducing poverty is certainly not the only goal a society may pursue. To share equally part of the wealth produced by a country between its citizens may be a social objective by itself. And in this case, a targeted program is not an option. However, if the question comes to fighting poverty, selective programs can be considered a viable option. Basic income was presented as a disarmingly simple idea. However, its implementation will probably be much more complex than its advocates admit. On the other hand, selective programs are considered complex, but they can be well implemented and managed, making them the embodiment of an equally simple idea. If our primary goal is to guarantee income to all, we need just give money to the poor. It can be possible, it can be effective, and it can be efficient. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm very happy to stay here today to see some friendly faces and also some people that I only know through internet first, and now I meet here personally. And I'd like to ask also, I need to talk actually 15 minutes if everybody agree, because after all, it's 4 years of pilot project. So I believe that with the presence of members of the government and the ruling party is no shortage here are advocates for Bolsa Família. This makes it much easier for us, saving time and labor, because after recognizing the merits of Bolsa Família, we immediately can go to what really matters, the proposition of a basic income truly unconditional and enforceable, not only in the micro, where we already operate, but the micro, in this case, national. As we do not intend to deny the merit of anyone, and we want to get right to the point, we have our first words by the recognition, and to remain no partisan, that both the scholarship and the Bolsa Família have to, for families' social welfare and economics in Brazil. Thus, merit recognized, let us citizens, after all, is the minimum that is expected for us, because however takes the initiative citizen paying a basic income in a country with a government program of national dimensions of Bolsa Família does not just have to see significant difference between both. After years of experience gained from the pilot project, we must have something more to say. And yes, we have. And this is a really shame that our minister is not here to say that to her. From our point of view, the dilemma of Bolsa Família is that it cannot stop or continue as it is. Back to the policies of the public who ask for the bread button, not even deserve mention. What should we do? Sweeten the bitter taste of the welfare's drug? No, thanks. Develop is accurate, but more than output ports we need without missing word is leaving the Bolsa Família and entering the basic income. How? That's the question. A gradual transition is proposed that initial analysis seems to be the most sensible. Decrease conditionalities until a given moment they said no longer exist and behold. No one feel or perceive painless and finally arrive at basic income. In theory, this is an excellent proposal, and this is the problem, in theory. Handling a battle, a struggle of political and economic interests as if there is likely to be faced with writing only. It is a piece of fiction, or rather bureaucratic. Then we cannot be offended when they accuse us of being advocates of basic income to being mad and utopians. There is no doubt that the pen is stronger than the sword, but we need less people writing and beating, and more people putting their hand in the pocket. In practice, it's a different story, and on the basis, we will make our propositions. If we are wrong, great, the Brazilian government finally begins the transition, and we just ask why it took so long. If not, again, while the Burser singer, we will work as a work ant. Perhaps this discourse sounds too pragmatic. It's not. Quite the contrary. We speak very clear that the transition from Bolsa Família to basic income is much more than discussing technical issues or public policy. That is why the discussion of the implementation of basic income cannot be closed in the transition of Bolsa Família for basic income. Why reduce the issues to mere reduction or increase of conditionalities? Because this is not, will not only lose in terms of proposition to not doing, not, to not do nothing. It's especially lose the libertarian and universal principle of basic income. Reduce the basic income as a government program and the unconditionality that demands respect, dignity and human rights to a simple technical question lost the action of the civil society, the most interested in nullifying the conditionalities. Truth be told, it's the only growing. This is not strange that the civil society do not base work and put their hand in their pockets to pay solidarity to the basic income, as the pilot project in Coatinga Velho. Above all, we must not forget that while we are discussing here approaching techniques, methodologies, on paper counterpoints that everything is beautiful and sometimes even well-intentioned, in the real world, people are not numbers, are counts or votes. In remote communities, the Coatinga Velho, Paranapiacabas and Otivero Omitara's Forgotten Life, which mailing there any explicit or implicit conditionality will constitute pure power relations. Does not mean that in each of these places reigns accommodation, clientelism, patronage, paternalism, dependence, but it's clear that if this is not the case in the merits of the parties involved in the personal relationships and not as a result of the system. As Oscar Wilde said, all authority is degradant. Degrades those who exercise it as those over whom it is exercised. When used with a certain amount of kindness and accompanied by prizes and rewards, it becomes alarmingly demoralizing. Individuals, in this case, less aware of the horrible pressure they are subjected, so go through life in a kind of rude comfort as domesticated animals, without ever realizing that others are thinking too, living by other people's standing, wearing practically what one might call the clothes of others, without being themselves by a single moment. Who is free, says a astute thinker, not satisfied, and authority to entice people to conform creates and natures a very crude kind of barbaric. So, worse than the employment trap that closes Bolsa Família and basic income overcomes, conditionalism brings in its wake a danger even more to democracy and citizenship. Every conditionality implies the suppression of the full exercise of citizenship, and a vein are open to state interference in one's life. And those who think that such interference is valid under certain conditions, it is because we have never seen in such a situation to suffer embarrassment and discrimination. Do not know what is being treated, screening with poor, as a people, or a livestock, or wheelchair. And I'm not speaking here as a researcher. I speak now as a resident of a poor community which not only saw, but I felt in the flesh what it describes. The true authority does not force, but give. Do not create conditionality, create conditions and opportunities. For the authority do not be itself a problem. It is necessary a pedagogical relation and not power. But first, the citizens must have the right in any moment to reject it. But from the authority, this is not enough. The true authority does not wait for the independence. They must work for the emancipation. It's only in your denied and not in your affirmation that the authority legitimate yourself. And just do your work when it becomes new and set free the citizens for your dependence. Education is not this paternalism show of society. Education is the process of social transformation of dependent people incapable, people with real freedom. The authority is only valid for a free education, and the authority who doesn't work in favor of emancipation, it is not educative and citizen, it is counter-pedagogical and authoritarian. The education has your own value and cannot be reduced, or a mere conditionality's counterpart. Especially the citizens' education that is only learned out of classroom. It is learning in the democratic and the social transformation itself. The intention or pretension of the social program must manifest first of all in the social program's methodology itself. The program must be thinking as a pedagogical process of empowerment of the citizens and not of doctrination or control. We must be aware that between Bolsa Família and basic income are discussing much more than sketches of government programs. We are taking the direction of a true citizenship or citizenship of a paper, which in practice means moving towards a state of direct democracy or less so, civil rights or economic or not so, the end of all forms of discrimination, including socioeconomic or not. No euphemism when discussing seriously the replacement of the Bolsa Família to basic income should be aware that we are pointing to two opposite directions and contradictory by definition of citizen empowerment and strengthening of the state, the control of the state. And who think the political representatives of government ignores this libertarian character of basic income and underestimate his feeling for power? The difference between Bolsa Família and basic income apply at least that has been put into practice so far is therefore not only a right to a care assist insurance law, but the approach and especially principles. The basic income is libertarian, is democratic, it's a citizen. Both aims to eradicate poverty, but the poverty basic income not only economic but also political. And so much depends on the methodology with which it is put in practice. It's completely fallacious idea that we should give up our personal freedom if we have some collective security. True freedom and security are guaranteed in the state as the real freedoms. The very uncertain about the deprivation of freedom, terror, and fear arising for the constant possibility of the loss of the fundamental conditions of life and livelihood is itself constitute an act of violence and the poverty. That's why we cannot reduce combat poverty materially, while hunger and poverty are the most severe forms of deprivation and emergency. Sorry. Its eradication cannot be done at the expense of political... Sorry. political freedoms and cultural rights of the citizen. Poverty is not only material, it's the state of economic deprivation of fundamental freedoms and cultural policy, not detached from each other, but integrated into one and the same capital. That is why it's mistaken who thinks that we distribute money in Coachinga Valley. We provide capital in all its forms of capitalized via basic income. We are not playing with words. Without this capital, money is paper without this network of trust and reciprocity. The financial system itself is only a cloud of numbers on the internet. Our commitment to the libertarian spirit and social basic income is so deep conviction that we have in countries with authoritarian regimes to democracy in disguise. And unconditional basic income will be a fake, a basic income in name only. For conditionality in these states, exception of right will be tacit and implicit obedience to the government itself. This extreme case is important to understand that without political freedom or full citizenship to basic income, and generally all income transfer tends to no longer be an instrument of libertarian to become of libertation, to become an instrument of control, and may even expand the instrument of oppression to the extent that the fear of losing it is constructed in instrument maneuver depend benefit of the masses, and that in any regime, even in a democracy, after all, nothing as a strong economic fear or anxiety in times of military or election campaigns. This does not mean that we should adopt the neoliberal posture of live and let die. On the contrary, we must convert the boon in law and adopt the redistribution of the common good based on the new social contract. More than contemporary surveillance state must guarantee real freedom as the basis for a true state of peace, not only in his letter magna, but the systematization of new institutions devoted to the emerging political paradigm that requires the empowerment of the citizen and not the other. In this sense, basic income inspires new indicators for measuring the performance of government social policy mainly. This evaluation involves two basic questions. As they raise it back in the fact to the hands of the citizens without giving lost its way, what goes into the hand of those in need? These efficiency rates, both operationally and redistribution, should be compared with the rates of social inequality to determine the efficacy and effectiveness not only of public policy, but the legitimacy of the institution itself. Contemporary states not producing reduction of social inequality have no morality to tax, because the tax that effectively does not reduce social inequality is nothing but institutionalized theft. On this subject, we have an even more sui generis position. Advocate a basic income maintained by voluntary contributions, which does not mean defending the ingenuity to survive with any donations, but any form of association or social contract between free and voluntary persons who are not obligated or forced, even if coerced by legal means, to finance a basic income each other. Especially because between traditional philanthropy and taxes, there are other forms of intelligent life possible, other forms of systematized, more efficient economic and legal action are possible and should be experienced by a lab to develop new public policies. And this is what we are currently doing in Recivitas, and this is on the experiments we propose to talk now, because it's very easy to criticize. Create workable proposition from this criticism, this is the real challenge. Our pilot project of Coachinga Valley has been criticized for being ridiculously small. Yet it is precisely in their diminutive dimension that lays its greatest strength and potential to design a strategic plan for implementation of the basic income scale, either in Brazil or international. Why not? The need for adaptation gave Coatinga Value very interesting futures. Their model of network community with low operating costs makes it not only extremely cheap, but highly replicable and much easier to become self-sustaining. Its returns unobtrusive, but significant in terms of human development and microeconomics, make it attractive for social investment, especially for not being inserted into the logic of social assistance programs, but within the solidary economic and financial associativism. It was the line that we now work shortly after the first results that pointed to the path of microfinance and culminate with the big bank, the social bank first presented at Hitsumeika University at Japan in November 2010. Nowadays, if there is something less well liked, that governments are the banks. But the creation of a social bank too is important for the three reasons. First, that the idea of a compulsory contribution is a contradiction with the principles of a basic income. Second, it's perfectly possible to eliminate bureaucratic costs when we associate financially through contracts where we assume the commitments of our income contributed and pay equal for all members of this community. And third, it gives financial inclusion as economic right, i.e. the social character that it must have, and the social character the bank owns. The social bank proposal can be put in practice by any community independently the common good that constitutes herself. As soon as they have the social capital and wish to applicate the principles of equitative contributions and equal redistribution. Supposing wish and with and social capital, we could, for example, make from BN the principle of this community and make a mutual security network through this Congress. But this mutual security network wouldn't have sense. After all, for the universal spirit of basic income, better will be construct this network through the mutuality borders as a foundation designated to finance a basic income experience all over the world. All of you, especially the institution, government, as Brazilians, could make some contributions. If there is no conditionality into what they put to sociabilize the lost in banks during the financial crisis. Actually, they are too big to broke, and society even bigger. And they are putting a bank router in the world. But this is obviously utopic. Even finance freedom and liberty and international territory is always easier than your own. Sorry for the representatives here. I also represent a juridical person. A solidarity network is not a job for a juridical person with a fake personality, but with a natural purse with real character. That is why I want back for the small world, but real and replicable. For what we are doing to multiply the real experience with basic income, like in Coatinga Value worldwide. However, for the sake of bureaucracy, we gave priority to the development of the investment fund of basic income guarantee. This is a simple idea. The income from this investment radar, then being pocketed by executives, go to the payment of basic income pilot projects, such as Coatinga Value. The fund is currently in phase of fundraising and already has more than $500,000 of reais in signed commitments deposits. And as the fund is officially constituted, which will require a little more bureaucracy and resource, will already be a more than enough capital to sustain Coatinga Value and other communities. That is why today we are announcing with great happiness that in January 2013, we will open officially the call for funding of new communities of basic income for NGOs and municipalities. And we invite everybody here to take part of the foundation of this solidarity network Borderless to join us. Some people think that this is not a basic income, that a basic income can only be paid by government. We are running the original conception of the idea. Quite the contrary, as Thomas Paine says, much of that order arraigned in mankind is not the effect of government. It has its origin in the principle of society and the natural constitution of man. The mutual dependence and reciprocal interest of every man to respect the other, and that all part of a civilized community has some relationship to the other, creates a great thread that holds it together. It is the great and fundamental principle of society and civilization, the common usage universally consented to and mutually and reciprocally maintained, the incessant flow of interest passing through a million channels, strengths the total mass of civilized man, is all these things infinitely more than to anything that can make even the best instituted governments, which depend the security and prosperity of the individual and the whole. With regards to all these matters, man is a creature more consistent than he knows and than government would wish him to believe. The spirit of a basic income has always been libertarian and walked toward universalization. Basic income closes a freedom and equality so real that even the nationality should lose their tacit condition for unconditional communion between people voluntary, willing to guarantee this right universally, without intermediaries or impediments in a borderless of a solidarity network. That's why the basic income should be an international initiative, because human rights and freedom of the magnitude of basic income cannot now borders or discrimination between peoples and territory, especially because if there is something we learn, not with the project, but with the invisible and silent struggle that keep it a community, standing virtually alone for 4 years, is that the basic income will never, never be given, for a very simple reason. It is not a blessing, it's a law, and fundamental rights and freedoms historically is not granted, but acquired. And what does this have to do with the specific proposal for the transition from Bolsa Família to basic income? Everything. There is no transition. There are two separate programs on purpose and principles. The best strategy to stimulate with tax incentives for investors or even allocation of resources for this investment fund for the third sector to delivering in basic income communities strategically, prioritizing the poorest location according to the maps of poverty, which the government has anyway. NGOs have the reach. Since the basic income resources is funded directly by private enterprise and the government's Bolsa Família, the two would act in a cooperative manner. The output of the Bolsa Família would then be natural, with its own exit from the poverty line, the first condition for it to start receiving the benefit. The Bolsa Família does not cease until it's no longer and falls naturally into obsolescence if or when the basic income performs its intended effect. We partly not only bet, but work for this moment. And we can say that this process of supplanting the natural basic income on the Bolsa Família will occur, mainly because basic income is not a program, but the foundation of a new economy. Soon, we will publish the data on a new experience that will complete 2 years with a new type of microcredit factored in basic income. And by the special characteristics of profitability and reliability that gives basic income, can recapitalize themselves without interest. Another teeny small revolution with the revolution basic income applied, and that this strengthens our proposal. The basic income is just the beginning. 4 years ago, we are just two persons. Today, we are a small movement, open to everybody who wants to take part of it. being as a volunteer, as a social investor, getting together with the pioneers who are opening this investment fund. This is basically our proposition to the Brazilian government representatives. We will respectfully wait for the answer, but working out in the meantime. Like a wise Brazilian singer once said, "Come on, let's go, because waiting is not knowing. Who knows, make it happen. Doesn't wait it for it to happen." Thank you very much.
I will break the protocol, because if you all accept, I will send this lecture by Bruna to President Dilma Rousseff.
Yeah, thanks, Bruna, and thanks Luis Enrique, and thanks Eduardo for this, and thanks also for letting me sit there next to you Brazilians. As a German who has always had a lot of sympathies for this country, and out of these sympathies has been following what you are doing over there. My job actually is to work with FIAN on human rights, and in that function I was in Brazil on and off observing what's happening there, and obviously for the right to food, the issue of a number of human rights other than the right to food, including social security, adequate standard of living, are essential. So I just want to look at this whole thing from a human rights perspective with a few words.
Quite a few initiatives taken to even more.
That looks a little bit different from the perspective of the government. And as a human rights person, I have to apologize for Bruna that I have to talk about states' obligations, right? And I'm very encouraged, though, about all these private initiatives now coming up in Africa, in India, and in Brazil. I think that helps a lot. Two questions I want to deal with. One is, why from conditional cash transfer to basic income? Why? What are the reasons? And the second question is the eternal question, how to finance the basic income in Brazil, for example. Okay. Why from conditional cash transfer to basic income? I think for a human rights person, there are a number of issues that are unacceptable with conditional cash transfers. Bruna has mentioned some of them in a different language. Let me just say that obviously minimum income is something that is absolutely essential for human rights. Talking about human rights without talking about the minimum income is just a fake. It's a fake. After a certain point, you're not anymore in a position to make use of your rights, to find remedies, and as human rights are universal, so the individual minimum income has to be universal. So that's quite clear. There are two issues here. One is that this minimum income is an individual right. It's not about statistics. It's about individuals, correct? So when we say we minimize exclusion errors, that's the wrong approach. There must not be exclusion errors, full stop. And if there is an exclusion error that occurs sometimes, then there must be remedy for it. That's what human rights are for. I mean, you have to have remedy when your rights are violated. And of course, there should be programs, minimum income programs, that minimize the risk of exclusion error. And then there are some minimum income programs that have built-in exclusion errors, and we call this conditioning. Conditioning is a way of building exclusion errors, or building exclusion, let's put it this way, into your program. The second point, what has to be clear from a human rights point of view is that these social programs have to be under the control of the people who are the rights holders. Okay? That means everybody has to be clear what her or his rights are. That means that these programs have to be fairly simple. Okay? And there are everywhere processes that are misusing complicated social transfer programs for political reasons. This is completely unacceptable. So, if we want to exclude clientelism and assistentialism, we need to move away from conditional cash transfers. Even though this might be a good first step, that can be debated, but let's take it that this is a good step in the right direction. We still should know why we want to move on. And that is something that I'm actually waiting for from Brazil, how to move on. My last point from the human rights perspective is that if you have conditional cash transfers or other means-tested programs at this level where you are dealing with extreme poverty, you cannot make these justiciable in the sense that you cannot go to court if this is violated because you're dead. All right? So there is something where we have to introduce programs that at least at all means, with all means, guarantee this minimum income. And obviously the most straightforward way to do this is the basic income. Now, I emphasize this quite a bit because I felt somehow that our Brazilian friends need encouragement also to move on from conditional cash transfers to basic income. I remember, I make a little anecdote, when we had in 2003, we had an international conference in the Philippines. And actually, that was the first time that Eduardo Suplicy and Fian cooperated. And I remember Eduardo almost convincing the Filipino parliament in these 2 days in Manila that they would introduce a basic income. And so we were close to it. And it still goes on with Fian Philippines, the work there. But then what happened is 2 months later, I think he sent me an email and said, we have a basic income law. I said, what? Yes, we have a basic income law. And then he sent it, this famous law, 10,835, that you all know now, of 2004. And I think at that moment you even went up to Lula, embraced him and gave him a kiss. Correct?
Yes.
Is that correct? Something that if you know Brazilian politics, you would not expect Eduardo to do every day. So at least at that point, the Brazilian government was clear that it wanted to move to basic income. And also that's why we have a secretary here on citizens' income. And we, in German, we say Bürger income. Basic income is the same, right? More or less the same. So the secretary is here. My question to the secretary, where is the plan? Where is the plan to move from Bolsa Familia to basic income? So, I mean, when we make our strategies in FIAN, we sit down and write a timeline, okay? In 5 years, we want to be here. In 10 years, we want to be there, and so on. And Brazil actually wanted to be close to a basic income within a period of 1.5 years. What was it, January 2005? So I'm wondering, actually, where is the plan? And maybe we can discuss a little bit about the plan. So since I got impatient, I started collecting data when I was in Brazil. So data on income distribution, taxes, social system, and so on. And I made my little model, which everybody can have if you want it. It's on an Excel sheet. And found out that in order to have a basic income, to move from bolsa familia to a basic income of 100 reais is very modest, and the data is like 10 years ago. There's a fairly straightforward reform that you can do within the social system as it is, cutting some benefits. There is, I think, a lot of need for reform in the pension system, where you can cut out a lot of flesh there and move it in the right direction. And you can really increase taxes, right? You can increase taxes. There's nothing wrong with it. I mean, the taxes in Brazil are so low that, it's almost like Switzerland. So I don't want to get into the details. I just want to invite you, I think it's somewhere on the website, to look at this model, in particular our Brazilian friends. I want to draw your attention to these two publications that are also available on the website. This is a study done on Bolsa Familia, human rights analysis, also on Zambia and Malawi. And this basic food income option or obligation is a human rights analysis. So it debates whether it's not really an obligation for states, or just an option. Thank you.
Wir haben noch ein bisschen Zeit, ich will jetzt nicht hetzen und würde jetzt einfach drei Fragen aus dem Publikum zulassen.
Ja, danke. Mir hat das alles gut gefallen. Auch das Statement zum Schluss von Fian. Nur wenn wir in Österreich wären, dann hätte ich nicht gefragt, wo ist der Plan für die Weiterentwicklung zum bedingungslosen Grundeinkommen. Da hätte ich nämlich gefragt, wo ist der Plan von der bedarfsorientierten Mindestsicherung zum bedingungslosen Grundeinkommen. Mhm. Und hier in Deutschland hätte ich gefragt, wo ist der Plan von Hartz IV zum bedingungslosen Grundeinkommen. Mhm. Danke. Okay.
Ja, gibt es da noch?
Ja, ich möchte nur einmal zu dem Vortrag von der jungen Dame sagen, ich habe das nicht so ganz verstanden, aber es ging auch um Mikrokredite und Mikrokredite sind sehr umstritten heute und ich möchte davor warnen, ich bin Volkswirt, dass wir versuchen, unser Grundeinkommen dadurch zu generieren, dass wir im Grunde schon wieder produzieren. Nämlich in dem Fall über Mikrokredite. Also wir sollten uns aus dem Produktionssektor heraushalten. Hier geht es erst einmal um Verteilung. Sonst werden Leute kommen, das kann ich euch garantieren, die wissen, wie man das macht, uns da über den Tisch zu ziehen. Die machen das nämlich ständig. Okay. Okay.
Ulsamba. Wir warten schon viel zu lange auf das bedingungslose Grundeinkommen und jetzt geben wir uns eben nicht mehr zufrieden, einfach nur die Armut ein bisschen zu beseitigen. Es gibt verdeckte Armut und es gibt Ansprüche, nicht nur in finanzieller Hinsicht, sondern einfach auch in Bezug auf den Lebensstil, den wir führen wollen. Also das heißt Umverteilung, gleiches Recht für alle und Freiheit auch in politischer Beziehung. Also ich denke, wir geben uns nicht mehr mit Almosen zufrieden. Wir haben den Anspruch darauf, auf ein Recht in Würde zu leben, alle miteinander und in ähnlicher Art und Weise und nicht mit großen Unterschieden zwischen den Menschen.
Yeah, first of all, let me say muito obrigado. I think we learned here very much how important this international exchange of ideas is. And let's really establish many of these international exchanges, Brazil, Germany, and so on and so on. If I have to be short, which is clear, let me exploit your presentation here as a learning for the German situation. I think you showed very clearly that all these kinds of detours to a bedingungsloses Grundeinkommen are not a good way. There are so many dead ends where you can be fixed. We have, I think, the easiest way to a big is the direct way to a big. Maybe that in special countries, like in Brazil, this idea of the Bolsa Familia was a good idea and important. That's not my point. But we have many discussions in Germany. We say, let's do this step first, and the other, and the other. And at the very end, there will be the big E or the big. I don't believe in this strategy. Muito obrigado.
Hello, my name is Luis. I work with Bruna in Recivitas, and I just make an add a comment about a general misconception that we have here about the Brazilian taxes. In fact, the Brazilian taxes, because this is what I've been heard and in the other workshops, is that always a suggestion of increasing taxes to pay the basic income. In Brazil, taxes are not low at all. If you take a percent of the GDP, total taxes are about 34% of GDP. And for a developing country as Brazil, this is very, very high. It's comparable to European countries, okay? The developing countries that compete with Brazil for producing goods, mostly in Asia, they have an average of about 20% of GDP on taxes. So in Brazil, what you can see is the income tax of individuals are relatively low. The biggest portion that you pay is 27.5%. And that's why it appears to be low. But in Brazil, for companies, we have a very high level of taxes, especially taxes that hurt the revenues. So even if a company that has no profit or lose money, they pay taxes on revenues. And also the cost of labor in Brazil is very, very high compared to other emerging countries. So just to add my point here is that increasing taxes in Brazil is not a way of funding the basic income. I believe there's several other ways, as it was mentioned here, in the pension system in Brazil is very inefficient, especially the public sector pension, where there's a lot of place that to be cut, and also there's a lot of other inefficiencies that we can get reduction in the budget to use this money to pay basic income. But increasing taxes or creating taxes of natural resources is not. I don't believe is an option, because lately what we saw in Brazil is whenever the government tried to increase taxes, there's a very strong reaction of the society towards it. So it's not a very easy option.
Okay.
Just to add a comment, yes, the tax burden in Brazil is not low. It's really high. It's about 35% of GDP, and so to continue to raise it, it's not easy. But I have to make a small correction. The tributary system, the tax system in Brazil, is not based on payments by firms. It's payments by consumers. Because firms transfer these to the consumption. So it's an extremely regressive tax system. And if you want to change the situation in Brazil, one of the most important challenges is to make it more progressive. It's one of the basic things you have to do. But again, for basic income and for basic system, to have a good objective is not enough. Unfortunately, policies are not made in a vacuum. They are made out of possibilities that are done by politics. So we have financial constraints. We have battles in politics, just to mention one of them. We asked Senator Suplicy the other day to help us because one bill is in the Congress addressed to increase the number of, several bills are in the Congress, but this one is almost getting passed, to increase the number of conditionalities to the Bolsa Família program. And so we asked him to help us to talk to one of the senators that it is proposing. But it's it will be difficult to hold this project right now. So we are not making policies in a vacuum. We are making policies in an environment, in a difficult environment sometimes. And there was a politician in Brazil who said that the politics is the art of the possible, and we are used now to say that is to make more than what is possible. But even so, not everything is possible, and you have to be cautious with that. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I mean, the tax increase that I calculated, we can discuss afterwards, okay, is like from 36 to 40, okay, plus a basic income. And I think if you get a basic income, you may also be looking at a tax increase with different eyes, especially if you get calculated that you're on the winner's side, like 70-80% of the population, if not 90, are on the winner. They have, after taxes, more money than they have before, even with the tax increase. And then there, in Brazil, you have these indirect taxes, right, which are also not progressive enough as they should be. I think the poor carry like 25%, at least like 12 years ago, I don't know what it is today, but 25% of their income, they have to pay indirect taxes. So that is also quite heavy. That could be a reform, but I completely agree with you. There are reforms without raising taxes that could generate more than 60 or 70% of the money needed. So that could keep the tax increase really small.
Well, first I would like to tell you that I want to thank very much for the exposition of the Secretary National of the Citizens Basic Income, Luiz Henrique da Silva de Paiva, because I agree that the Bolsa Família, since it was inaugurated in 2003 and before, well, joining four previous programs that started in 1995-97, they had very positive results. Year after year, there was a reduction in absolute poverty in Brazil, significant, a reduction from 0.59 of the Gini coefficient in around 2002 to 0.519 at the beginning of this year, 2012. Infant mortality in Brazil, for example, decreased about 47% in the past 10 years. So it has had results that were very important. And those were steps in the right direction. But I fully agree with Bruna about the advantages of the citizens' basic income, the unconditional basic income, that is the cause of all of us here together. And I'm very happy that a member of the Brazilian government is here to listen to all those arguments that in the 3 days we will have. I also would like to tell that I'm fully convinced that once we persuade, as we are, more and more the people, and for this we must do it every day, like Bruna and Marcos and you of the Rede Civita is doing every day, and now Marina Nóbrega and Francisco Nóbrega that are doing the experience in Santo Antônio do Pinhal, we must spread our word and say, like you all here, how the citizens' basic income will really provide real freedom to all. Dignity, as Bruna was so well arguing in favor. That's why, well, I would like to send both the defense of the Bolsa Família to President Dilma and to and Bruna's defense of the citizens' basic income to President Dilma, and I will refer to both in my speech next Monday in the Brazilian Senate. But there are more arguments. I'm fully persuaded about the basic income also because from the point of view of a developing economy such as that of Brazil, I believe that it will make our economy more competitive with respect to the others that will not institute the citizens' basic income. I have been lecturing at the Palatino, and I have presented with the Maria Soledad Vela from Ecuador, a project to be a model for the 23 nations of Latin America and the Caribbean that is annexed to my, attached to my paper here, for all Latin American and Caribbean countries to introduce a basic income. And I have argued to them that in the United States, in Great Britain, in other developed nations, you have income transfer programs such as the Earned Income Tax Credit, the Family Tax Credit, that provide a complement of income to those who work and don't have enough income to get out from poverty. For example, a family of two, of husband, wife, and two children in the United States, if they get $18,000 per year as wages, they have the right to the earned income tax credit of $5,260 more, and they go up to $23,150 or so, $250. That is above the income level, the poverty level for families of wife, mother, well, husband, wife, and two children. And we must be aware of that. And one way would be to make something similar or even better. And what is even better is the citizens' basic income. And where is the proof? Well, in the book now by Carl Weiderkist, Howard Sherman, and others, and our economists from Alaska, the proof is there. It is in the place of the world where the citizens' basic income exists. How can I prove that? The result of the Alaskan experience. After 30 years of the Alaska Permanent Fund dividend system that started to pay to all inhabitants living there for a year or more, first 300 and 400 and 500 and so, in 2008, $3,269 per capita. In a family of five, $16,000 per year. What was the result of distributing about 6% of the gross domestic product to all Alaskans for 30 years? Well, the Gini coefficient of the United States in 2011 was 0.47. In the most unequal unit of the United States, the District of Columbia, where Washington, D.C. is 0.533, even higher than that of Brazilian today. And that of the Alaskan state, 0.40. It has made Alaska the most equal of the 50 American states. When, in 1976, Jay Hammond proposed the Alaska Permanent Fund to the Alaskans, the result in a referendum was 2-1, 76,000 yes, 36 no. Today, it is considered political suicide, even for Sarah Palin, the governor of Alaska in 2008, to propose the end of the Alaska Permanent Fund dividend system. So when we explain well to the people the advantages of the citizen's basic income, the unconditional basic income, in general, most of the people agree. So we all here have a tremendous job, function, to explain to the people even more. So I would like to compliment you all that founded Bien in 1986, because now we have here more and more people to spread the word to all countries in the planet. Congratulations to you all.